Good morning. I want to thank you, deacons and church, for always expressing love to us. I will tell you that we continually talk about the culture and the environment of this church and how loving you are, and how you also have made a decision to partner with us in fulfilling the vision of God for this community and through the ministry of this church. So thank you for that. I just want to share a couple things before we tune into the Word, and I really feel like God wants to speak some things today. He wants to deposit some things today, and I'm praying our hearts would capture it. I'm praying our hearts would be open to receive. But before we do that, I want to say that you heard a little bit about Angel Tree, and I want to thank you for the participation in that. I know most of our ornaments are gone. I believe there may be 7 or 8 left. If you want to grab one when you go, if you've not been able to do that, and help us out with that. But basically what it does is it provides Christmas gifts for children of incarcerated parents right here in Minnehaha and Lincoln County. And what a way to shine the light of Jesus into one of the darkest moments of people's lives. And so we're excited about that. But not only that, on December 18th, Wednesday night, we're pausing all other activities, and we are going to be hosting an Angel Tree banquet that night to be a blessing to the families of those incarcerated people. The entire family is being invited to come and enjoy a dinner to receive their gifts. Now, obviously, we don't know who's all going to respond. They're starting to respond. But I believe it's a beautiful way for us to say, you know what? Our doors are open to you, right? And no matter what's going on in your life, we want you to come and receive. But we want you to know that we're here to love on you. We're here to build relationship with you. And that's why we need you to help us serve that night. It may be serving food. It may be being the bus boy or the bus girl. It may be just opening the doors or greeting people. But we really want these people to see Jesus in our church and in us specifically. So you can go to SiouxFallsFirst.com. You can sign up there, register there, and just let us know if you're able to be there. Everything will be focused on that event. I also wanted to mention to you that we had another person in our church that went to be with the Lord. Chris Dyer. You know Chris and Renee, amazing, amazing people. And it's been quite a journey the last year for him. And we know that he is experiencing his complete healing right now. And even though it's hard, we know it's difficult during this Christmas season. We're praying for her, supporting her. But I wanted to let you know, because it just happened that Tuesday night from 5 to 7 p.m., right here at Miller West, right next to us, will be the visitation. The family will greet you. And then 11 a.m. right here at the church will be the memorial service. If you are willing to serve, if you're willing to help us serve lunch, I believe there's going to be approximately 150 people that will stay right after the service. And if you're willing to help us out with that, so Jenny doesn't have to make a bunch of calls tomorrow, you can just let her know or send her an email, info@SiouxFallsFirst.com. And I know she will be blessed by your willingness to serve. Thank you ahead of time. So if you have your Bibles or devices, you can go ahead and turn to the book of Luke chapter 1. And then when you get there, you can go to Matthew chapter 1. We'll be reading out of both of those texts today. But I'm just going to pray that the Holy Spirit would marinate our hearts and make us ready to receive what he wants to speak today. Whether we're in this room or watching online, we greet our online campus. We're glad you're with us. But I believe that when God speaks, when God is speaking to us, we need to open our ears. We need to listen. And I believe today God wants to deposit something in you. I believe he wants to speak to you personally. Amen? So Father, we love you today. And God, we thank you for the privilege of being able to come and to take a seat. Lord, to be able to tune in online and to be able to hear and experience the voice and the presence of God. I pray, Lord, that there would be no hindrance. I pray nothing would stand in the way. I pray nothing would cloud our sight or deafen our ears to receive what you want to speak today. Whether we're in this room or watching online or watching later, we believe, God, that you want to communicate your heart to your people today. Father, I'm praying for supernatural encouragement to rise out of this house today. Lord, we love you. Minister all across this campus today, and we'll give you thanks for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, there was a lady who was baking cookies and cakes in preparation for her family to come for Christmas. When suddenly she receives a knock at the door, she answers the door, and there's a gentleman standing there that asked her, "Is there anything I can do for you? I'm trying to get a few bucks before Christmas, and I just wanted to offer my assistance to you." And so she goes, "Well, yeah, do you paint?" And he goes, "Yeah, I'm a pretty good painter." And she goes, "Well, there's 2 gallons of green paint, a brush, and a porch out back that needs painted. You go ahead and paint that, come back, and we'll look at the work, and I'll pay you accordingly." He said, "Great." He said, "It won't take me very long." So he gets the paint and the brush, and he goes, and she kind of forgets about what's going on. She continues to bake her cookies and her cakes when all of a sudden she was interrupted again by a knock at the door. She goes there and opens the door, and it's the gentleman standing there, and he's got some paint on his clothes, realizing that he's fully engaged in the job. And so she asked him, "Did you finish the job?" He said, "Yes, I did. But lady, I have to correct you on one thing. That's not a Porsche out back, that's a Mercedes." Now, how many know that life is full of surprises? The great theologian Forrest Gump once said, "Life is like a box of chocolates. You just never know what you're going to get." So we're continuing our Christmas, We're On It series today as we are uncovering the story of hope and discovering the implications of Christ's birth on this world. And today, we're going to talk about facing the unexpected. Now, how many know that we are people of routine? I mean, we protect it. We like routine. We like our habits. We like to know what's going to happen, right? We learn to expect certain things. In fact, one thing we learn is that there are 4 seasons in South Dakota, and the longest one is winter. We learn that the sun's going to come up in the morning, no matter how dark it is the night before. We learn that you have to pay for what you get, and you get what you pay for. We learn that if you speed, eventually, you're going to get a ticket. You see, life has norms that we really gain a sense of comfort by, that we get used to, we acclimate to. But there are moments in life when we are caught by surprise. The orderly world that we seem to live in gets completely turned upside down. And in spite of our efforts to construct a predictable world, there are many unpredictable elements throughout our lives. You see, life doesn't always go as planned. It doesn't always go as we hoped or as we dreamed. We realize that there are things that seemingly come out of the blue. There are things that catch us by surprise. In fact, actually, one of the greatest sources of stress and anxiety is the need to adjust to the unexpected. In fact, life is seldom what we plan, but it's often what happens to us on the way to what we've planned. And I know that I'm speaking your language today because I know that as humanity, this is what life is about. This is the accumulation of experiences. And our lives are very similar to the lives of Mary and Joseph, who were living fairly predictable lives when suddenly they encounter the unexpected. So I want you to read with me Luke chapter 1, beginning at verse 26. It says, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You found favor with God. You'll conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. Now I want you to go back to Matthew chapter 1. I think I read more than I was supposed to if it didn't show up on the screen. Matthew 1:18. That was Mary's account. Now we're going to read Joseph's account. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." So Mary and Joseph, both individually, come face to face with the unexpected. We learn from the story of Mary and Joseph that if we don't learn to incorporate the element of surprise in our lives, that we will break. In fact, I've heard the adage that blessed are the flexible, for they shall not break, right? And this is where Mary and Joseph were, but not only will you break, but you'll miss out on God's best for your lives. So today I want us to look at a couple truths that we gather from this story on what to do when we're facing the unexpected. Because I know some of you today may be exactly in that place in your life. Maybe it's in your vocation, maybe it's in a relationship, maybe it's in your finances, it's in some business decisions you have to make. All of a sudden you find yourself facing the unexpected. And I believe through this story, God wants to teach us some things today that will encourage our hearts with the truth of God. The first one is this, that good things are often veiled in seasons of uncertainty. You see, we are not very comfortable when situations cause us to feel like life is spinning out of control, that we're facing the chaotic. We spend a lot of time and effort in keeping surprises to a minimum. I know that's how I live. However, our ability to cope with the unforeseen circumstances of life will determine what happens after that, will determine what happens next. In fact, I've learned that even though we don't feel it in that moment, that if we will place our trust and our faith in God, good things are often on the other side of uncertainty. In fact, Mary and Joseph were living an ordinary existence, just like you and I. They had met one another, they had fallen in love, they became engaged to be married. They demonstrated integrity and purity in their relationship, signified by the fact that Mary was still a virgin. Mary was probably approximately 14 years old, and Joseph was a few years older than that. They were doing things right. They were excited. They were living the dream. They were planning their wedding with their parents and had great expectations on the future. Everything was humming just like they thought it would. When suddenly an angel approaches both of them individually and informs them of Mary's pregnancy, supernaturally conceived by the Holy Spirit. Now, put yourself in their shoes for a moment. Life just came to a screeching halt. Everything just stopped right there before them. They were facing the unexpected. What would we do now? What would happen now? What would the future look like? How would it change the trajectory of the dreams that they had for their future? Well, first of all, I want us to see a glimpse of the character of Joseph. Look what it says. Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. So you got to understand, in Jewish culture, engagement or betrothal, you read about betrothal, was really a formalized greater level of commitment than engagement on the way to marriage. So the vows were important, the commitment was important, the time of preparation was important. In ending an engagement or a betrothal in Jewish culture due to infidelity was a big deal. So if Joseph wanted to recover the bride price and keep the dowry that he committed, he needed to prove that Mary was unfaithful in a public trial before all the people. This was their culture. These were their standard operating procedures during that time. And so the pregnancy would make that easy. He could say that they had never been together, and here she was pregnant. You see, Joseph, as he began to process what was happening, processed his love for Mary, realized he couldn't do this. So while he was going to divorce her, he was going to do it quietly and lose out on other things, including his own reputation, by sparing Mary the shame. And yet the angel of the Lord showed up on the scene in a dream and convinced him. How many know the role of the Holy Spirit is to convince? Convict. Right? And we know that the Holy Spirit is continually convincing us of what we need to do in life, how we need to avoid this, how we need to embrace this. The Holy Spirit is a communicator that leads us into all truth. And here he came to Joseph and he let him know that Mary was pregnant by the Holy Spirit. It was a supernatural conception. And that she would give birth to a boy by the name of Jesus who would be the Messiah. And here's what happens. Joseph, even though there was a lot of things going on, surrendered to the plan of God in the midst of uncertainty. And so today you may be battling some expectations that have not been fulfilled. You may be living and facing the unexpected. You may be dealing with some disruptions in life. I believe the Lord would deposit the word inside of you today that you need to trust his good plan. You need to know that God is good and the Holy Spirit is on the scene no matter where you find yourself to guide you and lead you into all truth. And Joseph surrendered to the plan of God. Regardless of the external perception that he would face or the internal affliction that he would feel, he said, I trust you, God. Now we go to Mary. So Mary gets a visitation from the angel telling her that she's been highly favored. She's been chosen. That her name has been called, the price is right, right? I mean, doing her own thing, minding her own business, planning for a wedding. And all of a sudden, the angel of the Lord says, hey, I'm coming to tell you that you've been chosen, highly favored. You're going to become pregnant by the Holy Spirit. And you're going to give birth to a boy named Jesus, who's going to grow up to be the Messiah, the Savior of the world. Now, you can read through that passage, and you see that there was some struggle going on in her heart. That she was having a hard time embracing what was being spoken to her. There's this internal wrestling match. And yet after this dialogue and after the Holy Spirit obviously confirming what the angel was speaking, we read her response to the angel in Luke 1:38. When it says, I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered, may it be to me as you have said. She also surrendered to the plan of God. So Mary and Joseph were both given an assignment and an opportunity to trust God in the midst of uncertainty. Courage would be essential for them to get on with life and embrace everything that was ahead of them, because they would experience the public scrutiny of those on the outside. They would face the shame of what things look like, because we know that we are a people that we like the way things look on the outside, and we don't want anything to look off. And because this would look off, because this would look like they were guilty or they had done something wrong, all of a sudden they're having to face, how are we going to embrace the plan of God? And yet, they do. And as they do, we know that the trust that they had in God would lead to the birth of Jesus in a Bethlehem stable. And I think, again, what it teaches us is that good things are often veiled, hidden, in seasons of uncertainty. So we can't get stuck where we are. We have to proceed into everything that God has for us. Because maybe you're here today and you're facing a painful season. Whether you're in this room or you're watching online, maybe life doesn't look at all like you thought it would look at this time in your life. Maybe circumstances have happened that you never dreamed of, and you are facing the unexpected. And you're wondering what tomorrow looks like, and you're wondering what next week looks like, and you're wondering what next year looks like. There's so many questions in your mind as you're trying to process where God is in this and how God is leading and where God is directing. And the feelings and the emotions that you're experiencing even right now are very similar to that of which Mary and Joseph experienced. And I believe as we learn from them, we have to remember that it's easy to get focused on what's immediately in front of us, that we fail to see what God wants to bring out of it. Let me tell you something. Whenever the enemy comes and disrupts things, you got to know God is going to make him pay it back with interest. You know, there's greater things coming that the enemy can, I mean, we learn this from the life of Job, that the enemy would come and the enemy would try to pick a fight and the enemy would try to oppose us and come against us, but God always has the final word. And what God wants to do in your life supersedes anything that the enemy can do to try to discourage you or try to put hopelessness in you. God is going to bring things out, and that leads to the next truth that I pray is sealed on your heart today. And that is, if life isn't good, God isn't done. So don't stay there where life isn't good. Know that the truth of God's word says that God is not done. He who began the work in you will complete the work in you in the day of Christ Jesus. But how easy is it for us to become spiritually stranded in a mindset of disappointment? Things have happened, things have taken place, and even though nobody else may know about it, in our minds, we are processing this disappointment and we become stranded rather than moving into the promises of God that He has already established for us. There's a tendency for us to get a distorted perspective, evidenced by our actions and by our words that we speak. How many notice that when something happens out of the blue, when we face the unexpected, it's so easy to become negative, pessimistic, hopeless, and we feed this feeling of frustration with our complaints and with our words that we speak, thinking somehow that we are stuck here. So how do we retain hope? How do we retain hope when we are battling fear, when we're facing the unexpected? This is very important for you to get. How do we retain that hope? How do we embrace that hope? Hope is a byproduct of understanding the character of God. Let me say it again. Hope is the byproduct of understanding the character of God. When you know God like He needs to be known, you know He's gonna come through. You know He's faithful. You know He's never left you. He's never forsaken you. You know that no matter how it looks today, that you can wake up tomorrow with expectation that God has better for you. Because when life isn't good, God isn't done. You see, biblical hope is confident expectation of the future, based on what is infallible. It is solid, it is concrete. You can take it to the bank. In fact, the writer of Hebrews says that hope is the anchor of our soul. And it's anchored in the heavenlies. It's anchored in something that is set, that it's established. The anchor of our soul means the anchor of our emotions, our mind, our will, our emotions. Hope is that anchor. You see, worldly hope is so different. Worldly hope is a hope so. I hope I get that job. I hope I get healed. I hope this doctor makes me feel better. I hope that my son or my daughter gets saved. I hope my parents get saved. It's kind of shot in the dark. It's wishful thinking. It's based on what is fallible. It's based on what happens around you. But friends, I want you to hear me today. Our hope doesn't fluctuate with the circumstances. We don't have hope one day and then lose it the next because something comes out of the blue or we get caught by surprise. Hope is the anchor, and the anchor holds us. No matter how the wind blows, no matter how the waves beat against our boat, hope holds us strong and secure. In fact, that's what caused Paul to say in Romans 8:28. I love this. He said, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who've been called according to His purpose." Now we know that all things are not good. In fact, some things are bad, let's be honest. Some things that happen, some things that come our way, some things that take place in our family, something that take place at our job site, wherever, we know that not everything is good. And that's not what he's saying. But he's saying, regardless of what you are facing, whether it's good or bad, God works everything for your good. To those that love God and those that live for his purposes. In fact, I was thinking about this and I heard it described this way one time, that many of you are also preparing for your family to come and you're cooking all the goodies and you're baking cakes and you're baking cookies and candy and all those things. I want you to think about it a moment. You get all the stuff out to bake a cake. You get all the ingredients. You take those ingredients individually. Some of them taste really bad, right? I mean, you go ahead and crack that egg and you may be rocky and maybe you can handle that. But I'm not a fan of raw eggs. I like my eggs cooked, right? But all these elements, you take them individually. Some of them are going to taste okay, but most of them are not going to taste good individually. Those ingredients. But the baker arrives and begins to put them all together and mixes them up and turns on the oven and puts them in the oven and pulls them out. All of a sudden, all those ingredients come together to create something that has a lot of good taste. And you know, that's how God is with our lives. Man, there's things you're thinking, if I take this individually, oh my gosh, this is bitter. It doesn't taste good. I just want to spit it out. But God says, listen, I come on the scene and I take all these things. I take all these elements, all these ingredients in your life. Hey, I know what happened years ago to you. I know what you walked through as a child. I know what you faced early on in your marriage. I know how those words affected you from your employer, from your boss. He knows it all. And he says, yet in all things, he takes all these ingredients and he works them together to create something good. In fact, he takes the batter and creates something that will make us better, not bitter. That's what he does for us. That's what he wants to do for some of you today. As you are facing the unexpected, in fact, God's plan for our lives cannot be thwarted by the enemy, no matter how hard he tries. The same was true of Mary and Joseph, who again, when they were told that, hey, your life is going to completely change, Mary is going to house in her womb the Messiah, the seed of salvation. It wasn't one of the best moments of their lives. I mean, they were like, hey, let's throw a party. Let's do a baby shower. I mean, it wasn't like that. It was like, man, life's going to be so different. It seemed chaotic. I'm sure it seemed confusing in some ways. And yet as they trusted God, as they trusted God's word delivered through the angels, they knew everything was going to be okay. In fact, they were able to stand over the one who would live a sinless life, who would die on a cross, who would purchase our salvation. You see, even in the midst of uncertainty, they were able to experience the goodness of God. You need to know today that God already knew the end of the story from the beginning in your life. He knows what you need. He knows what's best for us. And you need to take courage in that. But I want to close with this. Most of you are probably sending out your Christmas cards. And I know today it's a lot of pictorial Christmas cards with the greetings at the bottom. And we love the pictures of your family. And you'll be getting one of our staff. And but kind of the old school Christmas cards, the kinds you purchase at Walmart or Walgreens or Hy-Vee, I've never seen an ugly Christmas card of the manger scene. Usually it's so serene. You see the star and the angels and the shepherds and the animals. You see Jesus in a glowing manger scene, with Mary and Joseph cooing over their newborn son. And that's the image we often get in our minds. And I don't want to bust your bubble or anything, but that's not at all what it looked like. We learned this in the nation of Israel. It kind of messed with me because I always saw this picture and it really wasn't that picture. You see, when Mary and Joseph could not find room in the inn, they most likely went to the home of a family member. And there was no rooms available for them in that house either, but they said, hey, we have the chamber basically in the basement. There was a chamber that housed the animals. It was a cold and dark place. It wasn't like a stable at the back of the farm. It was something that was very localized in the basement, a place for animals. So can you imagine the smell of the sweat and the animal dung and just the environment was a filthy environment. And that's where Christmas was born. That's where hope was born. In fact, as I think about it, really, the depiction of the true manger scene is really a illustration on facing the unexpected. Because even though it wasn't ideal, even though it was an ugly place, even though it was a place that smelled, even though it was a place where royalty should not have been born, we know that out of the humble nativity scene came the King whose life, death, and resurrection would determine the eternal state of every human being. Every human being. So you need to know that good things are often veiled in seasons of uncertainty. And if life isn't good right now, God's not done. Amen? So Father, I love you today, and I thank you for this word of faith, this word of encouragement, this word that I believe you are using, God, to build us up. And God, I know that there are people in this room, there are people that are watching online, God, that are facing some difficult seasons. God, they're facing the unexpected. Life has been disruptive for them. God, things have happened that they never ever thought or imagined or dreamed would ever happen. And here they are. God, so many times they internalize and don't share, don't speak it out to people. But God, we know so often that internalization can create a prison in our mind. And I believe today, God, that you've come. You've come to provide the opportunity for us to trust you, to put our faith in you, to trust in God and his good plan, to know that in all things God works for the good of them who love you and are called according to your purpose. And I pray, God, today, regardless of what people are facing, God, they would express their trust and faith in you today. Heads bowed and eyes closed across this room. Some of you are dealing with the sting of disappointment. You're facing the unexpected. You're facing challenges that have caused you to really struggle in your mind and in your heart. It's shaken you. And yet, this is our opportunity to trust him. And if you're here and say, Pastor Quentin, that's me. That's where I'm at. We don't need to know what it is. We don't need to know specifics. But the Holy Spirit is saying, is that you today? You're walking through some things. Maybe from your past. Maybe from your present. Maybe fear the future. I don't know what it is. But you'd say, Jesus, today, I want to put my trust in you. That you and I can face the unexpected because there's always good on the other side of it. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Would you raise your hand and lift it up and say, that's me. Come on, make that declaration today. That's me. It's me. I'm going through some things. I'm facing some things. Just be honest before God. Come on, just be honest before God. Shake that pride off and say, that's where I'm at. That's where I'm living right now. Amen. Amen. Church, would you stand? I'd like to ask our prayer team to go ahead and come now. Let me also say, if you're here today and you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you're lacking, you're missing the hope of glory in your own heart. I just want to say to you, I want to encourage you to grab the hand of a person next to you and say, hey, I'm I'm willing to go up there. I'm willing to stand up there and would you take me? Would you take me to experience the Lord? But if you're here today, and again, you're struggling, you're battling with the uncertainty, you're facing the unexpected, we want to pray with you. Would you go ahead and come as we sing this song of worship?